Joining me now in the middle of Times Square is Arnold Donald, CEO of Carnival Cruise. Arnold, great to see you. Thanks for joining us.
Great to see you, Scott.
All right, let's start off with your announcement today. You're launching the first ever streaming digital travel channel. Tell us about it. It's called Ocean View.
It's called Ocean View. We're also launching our mobile gaming platform, Play Ocean, launching here in Times Square. I was responsible for the weather, you know. It's a beautiful day here in Times Square. But yeah, Ocean View is our digital streaming platform. We already have a number of programs on the major networks, ABC, the screens here, NBC right here, also the CW and A&E. So those programs you can binge watch on Ocean View. But also we have some specifically developed programming for our digital streaming channel, Ocean View, Go and Local Eyes. These are smaller snippets. All of them are intended to do the same thing, to share the human experience, to share the spirit of adventure, share cultural exchange, and basically to inspire people to go out, to travel, to see the world, and of course, to do it through cruising.
Right, and obviously these programs are available on many of your cruises, but they're also available on Amazon, Apple TV, Roku. So is the idea to sort of extend your brand outside of the cruise ship? Because when I'm on a cruise, I don't know if I want to watch a travel show. I want to go on that water slide that's on the roof of your ships.
Absolutely. Some of the ships have water slides, and some just have Et Cetera caviar and frozen vodka at 2:30.
All good options.
So depending what you want on your options. But the reality is, for us, this is an extension. You know, we already have the programs, but we do have 12 million sets of eyeballs across our 103 ships around the globe every year. And they do watch some programming. We have programming in the public spaces. We have in many of the ships big giant screens up on the Lido decks. And obviously we have the cabin room portals as well. So there's plenty of places to watch. We don't want everybody sitting in their cabin all day watching TV or watching, but people do spend time on it. And for us, it's to inspire. It's to inspire adventure. It's to inspire cultural exchange. It's to inspire travel, to consider a place you didn't know existed or consider a place you always thought about going, but you weren't sure about going. And that's what it's all about, is to share the human spirit and to inspire, you know, travel and adventure.
All right, let's talk about hurricanes, right? We've had Harvey, Irma, Maria.
We had Typhoon Talim.
Typhoons too.
Because we're all over the world. Yeah,
you're in
right.
China, which we'll talk about in a moment. But you still reported a great quarter, earnings beat.
A record quarter, yes.
But tell us what the impact will be going forward. I mean, update us on how you're dealing with the storms.
Well, first of all, obviously our condolences and support to anyone directly impacted, whether it's the earthquake in Mexico or whether it's from one of the hurricanes or any other natural disaster. Obviously, with the rest of the cruise industry, all of us together, we're there bringing supplies to places that needed immediately after the hurricanes. And also, obviously, through the generosity of Mickey and Madeline, through the Harrison Family Foundation, as well as our corporation, we're putting a lot of money. We pledged cumulatively, along with the Miami Heat, $10 million to go to various relief organizations. So we're serious about that part because it's so important to us. Having said that, the Caribbean is open for business. I have 20 ships in the Caribbean right now. People are having a great time. There's sunshine, there's vacation excursions, there's beaches, and so there's over 40 ports that we're going to. Every port in Mexico is open. So whether it's the Western Caribbean, the Southern Caribbean, or even the Eastern Caribbean where there was some impact, there's plenty of places to go and people are experiencing the Caribbean.
And only
only of the five ports that are frequented heavily by cruise goers that were damaged, they'll probably be back really soon. St. Martin's, I was there a few days after the hurricane. They'll be visiting with the people there and some of the government officials. And those people are resilient and very focused on getting their island back up and running. And we're very confident that they are going to be able to do that in a reasonable period of time. If they aren't, St. Thomas's and a couple of the other places impacted, there are so many places to go in the Caribbean. But those places will be back. Tourism is important to them. And it's a great economic engine to help the entire island come back.
And we're only talking about a 10 to 12 cent per share impact on fourth quarter results.
Yes, a significant impact, 10 to 12 cents. But because we're a global business, because this is part of our business, every year there's hurricanes, typhoons, cyclones somewhere in the world. Every year there's disease scares somewhere in the world, Zika, MERS, Ebola. Every year there's geopolitical tensions. These are things that happen every year in our business. And so we're used to managing these things. Our assets are mobile. We keep them out of harm's way. We take people to places they want to go. Last year, we had to stop going to Turkey for a period of time, and so we couldn't go to Turkey this year. And that was a high-yielding itinerary. But now we still go to other places in that region, and someday soon we'll be going back to Turkey.
And you talked about your relief efforts earlier. You actually sent a cruise ship to Puerto Rico with supplies to help in those efforts.
Well, we sent to a number of different places, actually.
How bad is Puerto Rico in terms of Maria? When do you expect Puerto Rico to come back?
Well, San Juan is where we home port out of one ship. We have a number of ships that transit into Puerto Rico. But the right after the storm, we had a ship that went in. We had 850 Puerto Ricans on board. We gave them the option of staying on if they didn't know whether their home was accessible, whether they could get to it or not, or to get off. The vast majority got off. There were actually taxis lined up to take them and buses. This was right after the hurricane. And so when you see stuff like that, you know that these places are going to be busy, you know, basically rehabilitating what they need to rehabilitate. For the port, is relatively more simple than it is for the rest of the island. But for guests to come and board a ship and to disembark, we think that'll be up and running in a reasonable period of time. But again, there's so many different places to go, so they should take their time, do what they need to do, and we have one ship, we can put it in other places. And that's what we do.
Do you worry about people watching on TV, seeing these pictures, and they're thinking, maybe I don't want to go to the Caribbean because we still have two more months left of hurricane season?
Scott, absolutely I worry about that, because what people see is a disaster scene, and they hear the word Caribbean, and they think that's everywhere in the Caribbean. Well, it's clearly not. Over 40 ports are open today for business. All of the ports in Mexico are. And so part of our effort has to be to make sure people realize that it's fun to go to the Caribbean. There's plenty of things to do. There's plenty of sun and beaches. And even the places impacted, it's important for them. They want to get back up because tourism is so important to them. And they will. They live in hurricane regions. It's not the first time a hurricane has hit these places. And they will recover. And they will recover much sooner than most people think.
And Carnival is actually leading in China, which is a very fast-growing area for you. Is that a good hedge against the Caribbean? I mean, obviously, there are weather issues in China, too.
Being global is a good hedge. The best hedge in the Caribbean is the fact that there's 40 ports operating. So there's plenty of places to go in the Caribbean. We're not going to replace a ship in the Caribbean and send it to China. We're not going to do that. But in a portfolio from a business standpoint, obviously, if one region is impacted, you're sailing to the Baltic and the Mediterranean and Alaska and lots of other places, and that all balances out. Because in any year, any one of those places could be impacted by anything. And so from a portfolio of business and the resiliency of our business, the reason why we're able to have a record quarter, we even raised our earnings guidance despite what happened. But the reason we can do that is because we do have a global business. And also, again, specifically to the Caribbean is alive and thriving. 20 ships are there today or more and filled with guests, fully occupied, people having a great time.
How important is China, though? I mean, what's your take on the state of the Chinese consumer?
China is the largest economy in the world. They have 135 million outbound tourists. Let's say somebody's double counting. That's still 60-something million outbound tourists, which makes them the largest outbound tourist nation in the world already. So home porting ships is important there, but we only have so many ships. So we're excited. We have six ships home ported in China today. We were the first there in 2006 from an international company standpoint. But the practical reality is we only have so many ships. We can't suddenly add another six ships there.
But
you
are taking delivery of 17 new ships over the next couple of years.
17.
What are some of the mind-blowing features on these ships?
Well, one of the mind-blowing things is we have the first purpose-built ship for China. So Shengshi Gongzhu Hao is the Mandarin name, and Majestic Princess is the English name. And she's in our princess line. She has Mahjong, a big Mahjong gaming area, karaoke throughout the ship, private gaming rooms, more private gaming rooms than you would see in a typical ship. Everything was designed specifically for the Chinese taste. It's the largest premium retail space at sea on any ship. So we have 1,100 square meters of retail on Majestic Princess. And those are all things designed specifically with the Chinese tourists in mind. But the other aspect of Chinese tourism is they're the largest outbound tourist nation in the world. You can go anywhere in the world and you see people from mainland Chinese there. I was in Cuba and Havana, they were there. I'm in the Great Barrier Reef in Australia, they're there. So they're traveling everywhere, which makes them great candidates for fly cruise vacations as well. And so as a source market, wherever our ships are anywhere in the world, China's an important market, as well as a home port market.
Now, obviously, technology has infiltrated so many businesses. Talk about some of the tech features on some of these ships and what we should expect in the coming years.
Well, I think the most exciting thing for us coming up soon is, of course, our Ocean platform, which is powering what you're seeing today with Ocean View and Play Ocean.
And some upgraded Wi-Fi, right?
And we'll have the best Wi-Fi I see with Medallion, that, no question about that. But it's powered by Ocean Medallion for our ocean-ready ships. Princess is going to be the first line with these. The Regal Princess will be the first ship that'll be ocean-ready. And what it is it allows the guests to have a highly personalized, customized experience. So the technology empowers our crew, because we're a hospitality business, it's people to people. It allows our crew to interact with our guests in such a way that guest feels like that particular cruise or vacation experience was tailored just for them. And it's a powerful platform that we're extremely excited about.
In your role, what percentage of your time are you thinking about technology?
I don't think about technology. I think about exceeding our guests' expectations. And technology is a powerful enabler to do just that. And so that's how we think about it. Everything for us is guest-centric. If we exceed our guests' expectations, all things are possible. So we're constantly trying to find ways to innovate around guest experience. And it produces things like you're seeing today, whether it's Ocean View or Play Ocean. You know, that's all coming out of one thought. How do we exceed our guests' expectations? Ocean Medallion and the Ocean platform for the ocean-ready ships, how do we exceed our guests' expectations? So technology is something we take advantage of. It's an enabler, it's a tool, but our objective is to exceed our guests' expectations. I have 120,000 passionate, dedicated employees that do that day in and day out, and that's what's powering the great results you see. More than doubling return on invested capital, more than doubling earnings in the last several years, well on our way to double-digit return on invested capital by the end of 2018. And that's all powered by exceeding our guests' expectations, our employees, and our travel agent partners that help get people on the right experience for them.
Arnold Donald, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Scott. A real pleasure.
Good to see you.
Cruise suit.